Hey everybody, it's Killer Minis!
You know, I really liked that, but I didn't like this.
Straight up. Straight up.
Movie abomination.
Chuck character.
Chuck Norris!
Yeah.
Chuck Norris!
Welcome back everybody, it's Scott with Killer Minis Wargaming. We'll go ahead and continue with the player phase. We'll move the first turn marker. And my team will go first. And what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and have we're going to have Nelly go ahead and or hold on. Anna's in the green. Yeah, Nelly's going to use her her free move action to go up one. Then she's going to spend an action to move into the zone for her first action. And then her second action is going to be taking a swipe at this door, regular door because it's red. And she gets a 6, so she immediately opens it, crashes it open. When she does that, remember, she creates a point of noise. So as a noise lesson, currently in this zone, we have the noise that that just created, and then each survivor constitutes their own noise token. You don't actually have to place them down. It's just understood that they each are the equivalent of one noise token. So the total noise value for this particular room is 4. This room over here is 1. So in the event that something was to move in our direction, they're going to move in the shortest route that they can get to this large room here with all the noise, right? That's how that works. And the idea there is, you know, sometimes you might want this one survivor to slip away and you'd want him to be quiet so as not to attract too much attention. Right? Anyhow, I digress. So she has one remaining action left. And there's not a whole lot that she can do. I think with her last action now, she can see Silas over here. And just to give him a head start, she's got that speed enchantment. So all she has to do is be able to see the target survivor, and she can from this room to that room through the open door. So she's going to go ahead and give that speed action over to Silas, and he'll jump out of turn sequence just up into the room, and then Nelly's turn will be done, and I'll head over into Anne. Now Anne knows that there's that runner over here. Remember, Anne has that bloodlust melee skill, which allows her to move up to 2 zones and attack at the same action. She's going to do that. She'll move and attack all in one swipe. She rolls, swinging with her hammer, which hits on a 4+. And there you go, that's a 4. So she takes out that runner, and I'll give her one more experience point, bringing her to 5. And yeah, she's doing rather well. That was with one action, okay? So now she has 2 remaining actions. And now you might have already noticed that, hey, there's really no way to get over here into this street. There's no doors. There's no doors on this side, anywhere on this outer perimeter wall. And I actually haven't talked about it yet, but this golden room, or, you know, dark yellow, that represents a vault. And then these yellow tokens here on the board, those are the doors to get to the vault. And with the vault, it's a new mechanic for Black Plague. It's designed to be there to act as basically an off-board location. So you can think of it like a tunnel. If you open this trapdoor, you get into a tunnel and you find this secret room. So it comes with its own set of rules that we're not going to dive too deep into, because it has some special line-of-sight rules, which we're really not going to need just yet. So other than that, normally an item will spawn inside there in the beginning of the game when you do your game setup that's going to be an artifact, which is like a special powerful weapon. But in this mission, they didn't put it in there. So, however, we need to get into that vault room in order to then open the other trapdoor in this room over here. So we kind of go underneath, off-board, underneath the game map, right? See how that works. So we'll enter here, and then we'll surface here. Once we're here, we'll open this door, and then we'll come on out, grab these objectives, and then at that point, the spawn's going to turn on, and then we'll make our way out to the exit. So anyhow, back to Anne. She already has one action consumed, so she'll spend another action to move over into the next room, and she's got one remaining. So she's going to take her hammer and swing. The trap doors have to be open the same way the regular doors, and hers opens on a 4+, so that's a 4. So the door is open. Now, one of the special rooms with the vault is when you open a door, there's no spawning that happens inside the vault rooms. The only thing that's ever going to be in the vault room is what you see when the game is set up. Okay, so it's kind of a defensive position, but it's more importantly a different way to move around the map without having to go through the map, right? And that's another reason why they set the board up this way, is to show off that new mechanism. However, I will say that it's not always the safest place. I call it a defensive position, but it's not the best, because one of the special rules is you can't shoot out of the room. I guess because it's like a secret room and there's tunnels on the way in. You can't fire out of it, and you can't see out of it like you do in a normal room. Remember, in this room, they can see into this room and see into this room. But once you're in the vault, you can't actually see into the other rooms. It's don't wrap your head around it. Don't fret it. It'll make more sense as you start to play. But that's just one of the special rules with the vault. So now Anne is completely, she's done with her turn, and Nellie's complete. So now we'll go on over to your turn. So a lot of the tough work's been taken care of. We've killed the, and actually I should have removed this noise token at the end of the zombie phase. We've killed both of the, we killed the enemy there, right? I tell you, sometimes that Blue Mountain Dew has got side effects. It just makes you stammer on. It's, I do love it though, so get used to it. Your turn. So Baldrick, now that the vault is open, Baldrick's going to go ahead and he's going to move 1, 2, and then he's going to, on his third action, go ahead and pop up over there in the vault. And he's done, other than having a free magic action, which you can't use. So, and then Silas will follow suit. 1, 2, and 3. Oops. Sorry, Silas. Didn't mean to. Oh, wow. Butterfingers today. Didn't mean to knock you over. So he's in the vault, and that's going to set us up for the following turn, where we're going to attempt to open up this trap door. So, in an abstract way, the vault door is also right here, right? You can see it from within this room. You can see this door, and then you can also see the other door, right? That's kind of how it's happening. So, anywho, that would complete the survivor turn. All four survivors have gone. And we'll head off into the zombie phase. It's going to be real quick and easy because, well, first phase is the attack phase. There's none. There's no zombies at all on the board. So we have to skip the second phase, which is moving. We head right into spawn. We only have one active spawn point. We'll flip the card, and right away we get a double spawn. So that means two cards at the next spawn point. Since there's only one, it comes right back to that one. So we'll draw two cards and see what we get. Okay, interesting. So we get another double spawn. And a fatty card, right? A one fatty in the blue phase. So before we get confused, we'll go ahead and put that one fatty down. And since we got a double spawn, we have to roll, or we have to draw two more cards. So I'll go 1, 2, and look at that. Now we got a runner and another double spawn, right? So we'll go ahead and pop the runner down and draw two more cards for that double spawn. You see how this can just really get to be, oh, look at this, it's a really wicked chain going on right now. So before it started, we're thinking, oh, okay, we might get one thing at the spawn, but it's not shaping up that way. Now we get another fatty, so we got a whole horde that's hot and heavy on our tails, and another double spawn, so two more cards till we get two regular cards. So we get a walker, and we also get in the blue phase the abomination. Remember I showed you the abomination? It's omitted from this mission, and in the special rules it tells you that when you see the card that says abomination, you do a fatty instead. So in this case we're going to put a fatty, two walkers in the zone. So wow, now we got a horde of six zombies, two walkers, a runner, and three fatties. We got a whole lot of hurting that's coming up behind us. About the only thing that's any good news about that is, well, there is a little bit of distance between us and them. But that also means that our back door is now cut off without having, you know, to get into a serious fight. So I'm going to go ahead and put these in the discard pile. So I hope you paid attention to see how those double spawns worked. It's a new mechanic with Black Plague, and I really like it. The old Zombicide had sewers, which were kind of unpredictable. And I think this is kind of their version of the sewers, but without the tactical headaches. Instead, you just have more show up at a spawn point than on the average than you would have before. On a periodic basis, it doesn't happen every turn, so that's kind of nice. Anyhow, so we will continue with the player phase now. Spawn is done, which is the third step. So we'll take the first turn skull and move it on down. And it'll be your turn to start off. So we want to move forward, right? So we need to get that other trapdoor open. Baldrick doesn't have anything that can open up that trapdoor. But Silas does. But Baldrick might actually pick up a weapon that can. So first thing that Baldrick is going to go ahead and do is perform a search action. And he finds a dragon bile, which is not going to help. A dragon bile is basically, you know, it's a liquid substance that comes, I'm assuming, directly from a dragon. It's that flammable substance. And it's a special piece of equipment where once we place it on the tile in a zone, later on we can pick up a torch and then ignite it with the torch. And that's what kills your game boss, right? That's basically the only thing that'll kill it, other than a special skill that you can earn with one of your starting survivors once it gets in the red level. Anyhow, so back to Baldrick, that didn't really help us. It's not going to help us swing on the door. But that being said, he's going to go ahead and take this great sword from Silas and put it in his inventory with his second action. And that's going to allow him to have one remaining action to swing on that trap door. So he swings in, all that work for nothing. He gets a one, so he completely misses. I mean, I'm not sure what he was thinking, a mage swinging a great sword. You know, low odds right there. But anyhow, so Silas is next. He's going to go, and that's unfortunate because now I don't know. I think Silas is going to go ahead and search. So Silas is going to spend an action and search, and he finds a shield. So that doesn't help him open the door either. He's going to take that shield and put it in his backpack. He's going to take a second action and grab his greatsword back from Baldrick. And then with his third and final action, he's going to roll to try to open that trap where he gets a two. And that's not going to cut. It's not going to cut the mustard. So yeah, he is out of actions, and your turn is now done as you've moved both Baldrick and Silas. So I guess it's going to be up to me to try to get that door open. All right, we will start off with Anne in the green. She's got that hammer. So she'll move one movement action into the vault, and she'll go ahead and swing on the vault door, which is over here, which you can see from the vault, right? She gets a five. So she, with one swoop, shows the boys again how to open the vault door. Now, once we do that, this room now has a door open for the very first time. So we have to spawn that room, right? And we do. We pull up two walkers in the blue phase. So we'll go ahead and grab two walker miniatures and place them in the room. And that's what's there. So now, remember, Anne still has two actions remaining. And she does also have that Bloodlust melee skill. So she's going to put it to use. With her second action, she will Bloodlust melee, which is charge and attack all in the same turn. Excuse me. And we'll roll for the attack, right? She's got a hammer that hits it's a one-die attack. Hits on a 4+. She rolls a 2, and that's not going to cut the mustard. And that's her second action. Now she's going to perform a regular attack. This time she gets a 6, so she gets one of them because there's only one hit, one dice, right? We'll take that off board, and we will give Anne another point. That's going to bring her to 6. That's unfortunate because she could have leveled up had she got that other another zombie, and she's out of actions. So now Nellie's going to take try to take a stab at it, maybe. So remember, Nellie gets that free move action for one. Then she moves here, free move action for free. She moves here with her first action. She moves here with her second action. And then she would go. She's going to go ahead and move in from the vault. She'll enter into that room with her third action. She has no more remaining actions. That's unfortunate. So this is that one scenario I was telling you about where you kind of want to try to not end your turn with a zombie in your zone. But it was really unavoidable in this case. So since Anne was in there, I just went ahead and moved Nellie in anyway. And that really just comes down to efficiency of actions. So I'm going to take a wound no matter what. So we're done with the survivor phase. I'll show you how that works. And we head into the zombie phase. And remember, the first step of the zombie phase, this should be getting repetitive, is the attack phase. The only eligible zombie to attack is the one that we're talking about in this room right outside the vault. So this walker is going to now auto hit us. And we have to select between the two survivors who's going to take the wound. So both Nellie and Anne, what's up with my characters being the one taking the damage? I don't know about that, but I mean, it'd be nice if I could give them to you, but you are not in the same zone, so that wouldn't be legal. So basically, we're going to go ahead and give that to Nellie. So thanks for charging in and joining us, but you're going to take that wound. So like I did, we just move the pip over, one slot over, into the one slot, right? And that's one wound. Okay, so if she gets two more, she would be out of the game, right? So one more is her safety net, and then she's done. So that would be the first step done, the attack step of the zombies. Next is moving, and we got a whole lot of movement that's going to happen now. Remember the noise, and actually when we banged open that vault door, it would have caused a noise token over there. So this is the largest noise, is Baldrick and Silas in the vault room. So these zombies are going to head toward there in the shortest route possible. Well, there's only one route it can take, and that's here to here, all the way up through the vault door and into the vault. Okay, so we still got some distance. So we move. Everybody moves one, because the walkers and fatties always move one space per turn. Remember, I said the runners are fast. They move two, so the runner will move up one, and then he'll be by himself further ahead into that that large crypt room, right? And that would be it for movement. So now we would do spawning. We still only have one active spawn point. So we'll pull the spawn card, and we get one walker, okay? So we'll grab one walker and go ahead and put it over by our spawn point that it belongs to. And yeah, so that's the zombie turn. We'll go ahead now and refresh the first player token, and it's my turn to start. So, which is good because I got some killing to do. So I think what we're going to do now is we're gonna level up Anne, because she's currently sitting at 6 experience points. And if she can take out the zombie, it'll be one more, and then I'll bring her into yellow. So, as I showed earlier in the previous episode, right? So, let's have her do that. So Anne's going to go ahead and swing her hammer. That's not how you do it. She rolls a 2. So that's one action. She'll swing again. She gets a 3. She just does not want to level up. So with her last remaining action, she rolls, and she gets another 3, which is a horrible miss. So, interesting. Sometimes it's how the dice work out. I mean, if you think about it, it hits on a 4, 5, or 6. So when you figure out the probability, you have a 50% chance of hitting when you roll once. So rolling with 3 actions gives you 3 chances to attain success on a 50% each time. So you'd think that you probably would take out that one zombie, but sometimes, no matter how much the odds are in your favor, it just doesn't happen, and that's the case here. So Anne's finished. Even if I had Nellie give her speed spell, the only thing that would do is allow her to run away. So now Nellie's going to try the same thing. She's going to say, I'll show you how it's done. She rolls. She gets a 5. So she attacks with her short sword, hits on a 4+. And she takes out this zombie that's in the room that's been plaguing us. And, yeah, we'll go ahead and give Nellie an experience point that brings her up to 3. If I can... There we go. Sometimes those little trackers get a little sticky. So that was her first... Was that her first action? Boy, now I forgot if she... No. Yeah, that was her first action. So with her second remaining action, she's going to take a swing at the door here, right? So, boom, she rolls a 1. It's a total miss. So that's her second action, and she'll swing again at that door, and what are the odds? Rolls another 1. And you can see that die just kind of landed and didn't even move, so that was a poor roll on my part. Yeah, she does have a free move action, but she doesn't want to go anywhere, so she can't get out the locked door. So her turn's going to be done. We'll head off over into your turn, and you are over up here in the vault. So the first thing that's going to happen, I think, is Baldrick is going to go ahead. And also, another thing about the vaults is you can't search inside there. They come with their own artifacts if there's equipment in there, and in this case, there's none. We should have removed this noise token during the end of the zombie phase. So Baldrick's going to go ahead and move over 1. And then he's going to perform a search action. And this time he finds chainmail armor. So the thing about armor is that when you go to ready it, remember I showed you the little body slot here up on the right of the, it's green. There's a little picture of a green cloak. So what you do is you just put that right there. And there, now he has chainmail armor on. So if you look at the text on it, it saves on a 4+. So what that basically means is the next time our party that he's in, so let's say in this room, if a zombie were to pop up and give us 1 wound, then he rolls a die for every wound that would be assigned to him. And if he gets a 4, 5, or 6, he shrugs that wound off and the armor absorbs the potential damage, right? That's a new mechanic to the game, one that I'm very happy about because before in the previous versions it was auto-hit, like in this version, so they're not rolling, and the wounds are very lethal. There's nothing that you could do, so it created a very methodical, tactical, every step of the way really matters type of game, which is fun. After you play it a few times, you start to go, boy, I really wish I had a way to either heal, or get an opportunity to dodge one of these wounds or something. So they went ahead and added that in. And in addition, there's also a healing enchantment that we haven't discovered yet in the equipment deck. So that's the other half of that, is now you can heal. So that's pretty cool stuff. Of course, you have to know that just means that, that's another reason for the double spawning. So that you have to make it a little bit more volatile in the game board, as far as the state of the game board, in order to, counterbalance those added mechanics that you've thrown in, because it can make things a little overpowered, right? So far from my experience, it looks like it's a pretty good mechanic. So we'll go ahead and continue. Let's see, Baldrick moved in there for 1. He searched for 1, and he's pretty much done at that point, right? That's all he can do. He can't get out that locked door. We got to bash it down. He doesn't have the equipment required to do that, and I don't want to spend an action and take it away from Silas, because then he won't be able to swing it anyhow. So we'll go ahead and skip over to Silas, and let's see. Silas will go ahead and move for 1 action. He'll join the rest of the party, and he will swing on that door. Okay, he gets a 4, and that door is going to open with a crash. That's actually a noise token that goes in this zone. And yeah, so that was his second action, right? So now we're finally over on the, and we're out back onto the streets. With his last action, he'll go ahead and move on out into the street zone, right? And yeah, so things are looking good for the party so far. Yeah, how are we gonna proceed now? So basically, that's the end of the survivor turn. We will continue. We're getting toward the end now, as you can see. Definitely looking good. So we'll go ahead and start things up with the beginning of the zombie phase. So remember, attack is step one. There's no legal attack, so we'll move right into step two, which is movement. So first we'll do the runner. He moves two zones, one into the large room and one into the smaller room. Now he's just a few squares away before he comes into our location. And all of these guys here all move one, so we're just going to push them forward into there. And this walker that spawned last turn is going to move up one as well. Still heading off into the direction, the only pathway to our survivors, which is through this trapdoor into the vault room and then out of the trapdoor into the streets. So still have somebody in our tail, but hopefully we can stay far enough ahead of them. It won't matter. Next, we'll spawn with our only remaining spawn point. And we're still in the blue phase. Now, I was kind of hoping we'd be in the yellow, but it didn't work out because Anne missed her attacks miserably. So we get one fatty in that spawn. Had we been in the yellow, instead we would have got a runner, which is a little worse because, you know, well, they're faster, right? They're going to come at you quicker. And as I had mentioned earlier, in some cases they can either attack you twice in a turn or they can move and attack, which is the only exception in the base game with the enemy that you're going to be facing. Everybody else either moves or they attack, and that's it. But these guys, they can do both all in one shot, so it can be pretty lethal. Anyhow, that's the end of the zombie phase, right? That was step three, and then remove noise tokens, which we'll do. You can kind of consider that like a maintenance phase, right? And we'll head off into the player turn. Probably move the first player token would be part of the maintenance phase as well. So now Baldrick and Silas started off. So now remember, if we look back over at the game board, we can't get into that room that has the magic circle. So that way Baldrick can perform the seance that he's going to perform, or the ritual, to get us teleported out of here. We can't even get through that door. It's a green door. It has a magical lock. So we have to pick up one of these two objectives in order to get that magical lock removed. So Silas is going to start. He's going to go ahead and move twice, and that's going to cost him two actions. And then he's going to go ahead with his last action and pick up this objective. Look at that. And that's the green objective. That's what we need. So as soon as it happens, the magical lock's lifted off that door, and now we can go through it. In addition, during the zombie phase, we're also now going to start spawning. This green spawn now becomes basically permanent. And, yeah, we're going to have two spawn points now. So that's interesting because we're going to try to be getting that door open. Now, important to note is the mission didn't call for all objectives to be taken. I'm pretty sure. So we don't actually have to pick up that objective. And oh, and I forgot, when Silas picked up that objective, that gave him 5 experience points, which is going to bring him to 9. So we are now in the yellow threat level. So not only does that spawn point become activated, but now it's going to be even more dangerous because it's going to, you know, give us a higher quantity or more dangerous foe on the average. You'll see. Plus, we've got 2 spawn points now. So not only do we have this large group running behind us, we're going to have this group that's going to try to prevent us from getting to our final location in that room. So Silas is done. Well, actually, I take that back. He would be done. But because he got in the yellow, we're going to go ahead and mark his yellow skill. There's only one to choose from, and that says +1 action. Now, it's good for you to understand that basically almost every character in the game that I know of, as soon as you hit yellow, you get a free action. So everybody starts off with 3 actions, and once you get that yellow phase, now you can do more in your turn, right? So that's pretty cool. So what that means is he can use that immediately. So his 3rd action was to pick up that objective, but since he leveled up, he gets a free action now that he's in the yellow experience, okay? So now with that 4th action, there's not a whole lot he's really going to do other than just go ahead, oops, not fall over, but he's going to move over to that central zone, right? and await his compadres. Actually, I wanted to say comrades, I'm not compadres. I think it's the same thing, though. Who knows? Anyhow, I digress. So, my next character would, or your next character would be Baldrick. So we'll go ahead and move Baldrick. 1, 2, and I'm a little weary about moving into that spawn zone, so we're going to hold off and see what shows up. But with Baldrick's, I'm showing Baldrick with an extra action. So he's going to go ahead and spend an action, and he's going to ready this longbow. And he'd still have another action left since he's in the yellow. So, he's just going to waste it. He's gonna hang back. We really need to just group up and make our final charge to that door. So, Nelly will start on my team. She's gonna go ahead and search that room once before she leaves. She finds a crossbow. Now this particular crossbow is nice because it'll kill fatties. It's a strength 2 weapon. It rolls 2 dice as opposed to 1 in the short bow, and it hits on a 4, 5, or 6. Important to note, though, you can only shoot it 1 or 2 zones away. You can't use that in close proximity in the same zone. So we're going to go ahead and for free, we're going to put that, change your inventory around, and put that speed spell up into her backpack. And that's Nelly's first action. Now she gets a free movement action, so she'll move out for 1. And then she'll move up for her actual second action. 1 was the search. That was a move, and then she had her free move. So she has 1 more remaining. But again, she's going to go ahead and just... they're going to stick tight as a group, and she's going to waste her last action. If she wanted, she could make some noise, but we're not trying to divert any attention away from the group. So we're not going to do that. So now Anne's going to go ahead, and I think she's going to follow suit. She's going to spend an action to search. Oh, and she finds chainmail armor. So first thing she's going to do is ready that for free, because that counts as an inventory transfer of your own inventory, which is free when you search. Yeah, so that's 1 action. Anne will go ahead and then move up for 2, 1, 2, and that'll be her 3rd action, and she's done. She still is in the blue experience, and so she doesn't get that extra, the benefit of the extra action. So that's the end of the player phase, right? We'll head off into the zombie phase, and remember, taking a look at the state of the board, there's no attacks that can happen, so we skip the first step. Second step is movement. So this runner here is going to move 1 into this room, then he's going to enter through the trap door and go off into the vault. So that's where he ends up with his action. Everybody else here is going to move, oops, not that way. They're going to move into this room and then come down and go out eventually. The runner here will move 2 spaces into there. So you see how that works. They're funneling toward the largest source of the noise in the shortest route that they can. And then we'll perform our third step, which is to spawn. Now this time we're going to spin off 2 cards. 1 for each spawn, and then we're going to go ahead and continue. Oh, we're going to go ahead and look in the next row, which is the yellow row. So we're going to get 2 walkers at the first spawn point, and then the brand new spawn point, 2 walkers. Okay, so fairly manageable. Luckily, we didn't get a fatty, but we had just found a weapon to dispatch that fatty in a quick-like fashion anyway, so we'll be all right. Okay, so that's the end of the zombie turn. Got no noise tokens to remove. I didn't put that one down. And that's it. We'll move the first player turn token, and we'll go ahead and start her up. So my team goes first, and we're staring down at 2 walkers that are in our way of getting that door open. So first I'm going to start with Anne. Remember, she's got that Bloodlust Melee, which is her blue skill. So she is going to charge forward with 1 action and attack. All with 1 action. That's a combo. Right? Boy, she just cannot roll dice. So she misses. She needs a 4s or better. So she's going to roll a regular attack with her second action. This time she gets a 6. This particular die is actually it's the exclusive die that came with a set. And this it's part of the Zombicide logo. If you look in the eye, in the second eye, there's a torch. So anyhow, that's a six. So she takes down one of the walkers with her second attack. And with her last... we should show you. So remember, that was her second action. When she does that, she moves up one experience, and we will level her up. So now she's got... She had one remaining after that attack, but she just earned her next free action, so she has now four every turn. That means she's going to probably take out this walker. So with her third action, she's going to roll... Oh, there's a skull. That's a zero. That's a one. So that's a miss. So with her free, her new found action, because she's leveled up, she rolls a one as well. So double ones there. Not very lucky. And Anne is complete. So now Nelly, my other character, she'll use her free move action to go on up. And she's going to... she's going to go ahead and swing with that short sword, because remember, her crossbow... Let me get into frame. Her crossbow is only good from one or two zones away, which is fine, because I really didn't want to use that crossbow and miss and hit my own people with friendly fire. Oh, what's with the ones? So her first action was a move action for free. Then she attacked for one action. She missed. She rolls again. Another one. Come on, people. So her last action, she swings. Oh, you got to be kidding me. Okay. If my gaming buddies, my regular gaming buddies, are watching this, they will absolutely laugh, because that is how I normally roll dice. I am known as the critical one guy. No matter what die it is, it's a D6, a D8, 10, 12, 20, 150, no matter what it is, I will roll an exorbitant number of critical failures. It never seems to amaze me. So we'll switch over to your team. And my one curse probably will not continue with you guys. So we'll start off with Silas. Now this is interesting. Silas is more accurate with a short bow. He hits on a 3+. And remember, that greatsword hits on a 5+, so he's less likely to get a hit, but he rolls more dice. So we're gonna go with that and not cause any wounds to our own people with friendly fire. Excuse me. So Silas will move forward for one and not fall over. There you go. And we'll pick up a different die. Actually, we're going to pick up five different dies. And we're going to roll this greatsword out. That's how you mitigate, a bad rolling streak. So you throw five dice as opposed to one. But notice I still got two ones here. The ones are cursing me. So there is a five. So that'll take out that one walker. And we'll go ahead and move him up to 10 points on his skill track. And let's see. So that was his second action. He's got two remaining, because he's yellow as well. So he gets four per turn. So basically, if you look at the state of the players, everybody except for Nelly is in yellow. And that's a good thing. You kind of want to try to level everybody up about the same skill level. So that way, as the game starts to increase in difficulty... you have the maximum amount of players to be able to withstand the increase in difficulty, right? So, all right, so Baldrick. Baldrick. He doesn't have anything to open that stinking door. So Baldrick's going to go ahead and move up for one. He's going to grab he's going to grab Nelly's short sword, because it's more accurate. And he's going to put it in his offhand for free. Like so. And that would be a second action, because it's an inventory transfer, right? Now he has two more, because he's in yellow. So he's going to swing at that door. Short sword opens a door on a four or higher. He gets a four. So bang. Opens the door. And even though there's an exit there, just like any other room, as soon as we open a door, we have to spawn a card. Spawn for it. So now we get an extra activation card. So all fatties get an extra activation and starts in the yellow phase. And we are in the yellow. So we go over here to this room where every fatty is, and we just move them up once. So remember, activating is attack and then move. There's no attacks to be made, so we skipped ahead to the move part, right? So fatties are coming strong. But we got the door open. We're looking good. And also important to note about that extra activation is when that happens, you're not actually putting any zombies down on a spawn point or the place that you're spawning that card for. So what that really means for us is now we got a clear path to get the heck out of Dodge. And I believe Baldrick has one more action remaining, and he's going to go ahead and move off into the room. Okay? And the way the mission objective for the mission state, the rules, the special rules, is that you have to start your turn in the exit zone and then leave. So since he didn't start, even if he had another action, I don't think he could escape yet. So, and besides, all the survivors have to leave. So let me check this again just real quick. Make sure I'm doing this right, because you know, after all, we are taping. So let's see. Reach the exit zone with all survivors. Any survivor may escape to this zone at the end of his turn as long as there are no zombies in it. And that's what your objective is. So we'll go ahead and that's actually the last player to go in the survivor turn, right? So we'll go ahead and do this what appears to be maybe the last zombie turn. So there's no attacks to be had, which is the first step. We'll skip right into movement. We'll move the fatties. They're slowly shambling down to try to get in that vault room. Remember the one runner that was in the vault, he comes out for one, and now he's here for two. So he's actually in the streets making his way toward us. These walkers come down. This runner comes one, two, and joins those walkers. And these two walkers here move down. And then now we spawn for the active spawn points. So first we start off with the west spawn. And we're in the yellow. And that is, hold that up for you. That's four walkers, excuse me. Getting a little hoarse after all of this conversation. So, yeah, the last spawn point, we get two runners, okay? So, that's not the best news. Not the best news at all. And you know what's funny is I went and read that for you guys, and I still can't remember. Any survivor may escape through this zone at the end of his turn. Okay. So, I'll go ahead and put the two runners. Boy, throat's really shot. Okay, we'll put the two runners down there. Okay, part of it is the super fast way that I talk. It's the Chicago thing. Let me get a drink real quick here. Where are we at? Blue Dew. That is the nectar of the gods. Okay. So that's the end of the zombie phase, right? We did two spawns. We'll start off in the survivor phase. We'll change the turn symbol, first turn token. So yeah, we start off with Baldrick and Silas. Is that right? Yeah, they finished the turn last. So Silas has a great sword. With one swing, he can basically take both those runners out, and that's what he's going to attempt to do. So he rolls. And he completely misses. Not a five in the deck, in the roll. So he will swing again. This time he gets two sixes, which is more than enough. So we take both of these as sixes. Each one represents one of the figures. Remember, the runners are just like the walkers. They take one wound apiece. So we remove them. We give them over here to Silas. Bump him up to 12. And, yeah. So... yeah, so I just ran out of my camcorder. So we bumped Silas up to 12, and yeah, that's how that goes. That was his second action. And then with his third action, Silas will move here, and with his fourth action, he will escape. Okay? Remember, the mission objectives require that all of them escape. But now, it's purely procedural, right? So now Baldur can go, and he leaves. Nelly free move, and then she leaves. And that also takes an action, by the way. And two actions, and she's gone. So that is it. Congratulations. We have beat the first introductory scenario. To be honest, it's not the biggest accomplishment. It's designed to be an easy scenario. Your other missions within Zombicide Black Plague, I guarantee, will be more of a challenge. And like I had mentioned earlier, that's kind of the fun, is being able to beat the level, just like in a video game, that you have to kind of keep playing each level to try to complete. You can try different combinations of survivors, different tactics, different types of equipment, and you can try different approaches. And also, you're going to have, you know, varying types of spawning going on. And then whatever special rules are for that particular quest and or mission. And yeah, so lots of fun to be had. I had a blast doing this tutorial. I hope it was extremely helpful to you if you've never played the game. I think at this point you should have a pretty good grasp to be able to sit down and play the game. Even if you were to go out and purchase it for yourself, I feel pretty confident that that we've covered just about everything. There's a few odds and ends that weren't part of the mission, and there's some things I didn't really delve into for simplicity, but really there's no real surprises. Like I said, the necromancer mechanic is a very large mechanic, and you didn't get to see that work. And what I would recommend, if that's something that's bugging you before you decide to make a purchase, you might want to check out my next gameplay video. It's called Big Game Hunting Quest 1. It's the first quest in the instruction rule booklet, and you're definitely going to see some necromancer action going on there. You can get an idea how that mechanic works, but trust me, it doesn't break the game or anything. If anything, it makes the game better. It makes it more chaotic and unpredictable. You never know when it's going to happen, and more importantly, it changes your each turn tactically what you're going to do. You may think, okay, going into this turn, I'm going to do this, and as soon as that necro comes out and maybe makes a turn or two, maybe a couple of them come out and they get some free activations going, next thing you know, you have to go hunt that thing down, forget what you were planning on doing, and charge back into that line, that horde of zombies coming your way, because you got to take him out, otherwise he can't potentially or may cause the end of the game. So really great stuff. I can't recommend the game enough. It is just one heck of a good time. So please, if you enjoyed it, leave a comment. I love to interact with the viewing audience. Let me know if you're digging it, if you found any rule issues, if you have any questions. I'm more than happy to answer them. Sometimes I don't always get back to them right away, but I will answer that comment. If you like the video, please, it helps out a lot. Go ahead and hit that thumb. And, you know, subscribe if you haven't already, for sure, so you can get additional content that I'll be putting out and more gameplay videos and whatnot. I got lots of Zombicide coming up, and also some other games I've picked up over the course of the year, if I can just find a quick way to pump these videos out. So between the taping and the playing and the editing and the wife and the responsibilities and all that stuff, it gets tough. So, you know, I'm going to try to get them out as quick as I can and try to toe that line of quality versus quantity the best that I can. So until next time, guys, I really appreciate it. Killaminis, peace out.